The way that I get started taping is just I get the lighting set up and boom, hit start. So there's no period of like thinking, okay, what am I going to say? What am I going to do? This is the same way in your practicing. You just have to jump into it quickly, like on a skateboard. You get on very quickly like that. And then once you're on it, you're fully engaged. Like once you're on the skateboard, it's like, whoa, I got to keep my balance now. So, yeah. Now, I had that great fall yesterday, and it's a wonderful experience because the Holy Spirit is showing me now what how it goes. So I have a very deep, feeling for it. How is it going to go in the world when we experience a very sudden, have the rug pulled out from underneath us very suddenly? This is what's going to happen. In an instant, the rug is going to be pulled out from underneath us. Now, nasty fall. Okay, I got it bandaged up and it's okay. I think I survived it. But it's interesting is the next day is I'm starting to feel now pain in the other hip. I didn't hit the other hip, but this leg and hip hurts a lot. The left leg and hip hurts a lot. The back is achy. My neck, I got a sore neck here, like whiplash. And there's a general feeling of agitation in my body, irritation, a lot of inflammation, you might say, is there. Probably should be drinking some cherry juice and working on the inflammation. There's a lot of inflammation, and it causes us of irritation. You lose your calm and peace of mind. I commented on this, and someone replied back, said, well, yeah, it's one body, right? It's just one body that fell. So you're going to feel it everywhere. And that is true. But guess what? It's one world, is it not? And when the rug gets pulled out from underneath us, everybody's going to feel that. It's going to spread. The agitation is going to spread all over the world. So it's not going to be isolated, especially with the social media permeating every place in the planet. It compounds the agitation exponentially. You can't even measure. That's why I say the crisis that now in this world now, the crises are much worse. They're not isolated anymore. There could back in the before there could be a coup in some country, a war in Africa, or someplace something happening, and none of the rest of the world even know about it. Presumably, I mean, in the mind knows about it, but they have that pretending that that's not their mind. Anyway, everyone knows everything, but they wouldn't react as if they're aware of it. Now, anything happens anywhere, and it's just wildfire, social media wildfire. This is why I had to, Holy Spirit had me boycott the news, boycott a lot of stuff, because of the inflammation and the amount of thoughts that you pull in is terrible. Someone gave a great quote on Facebook. It was their own words, I believe, that they said, silence can generate thoughts, but can give birth to thoughts, but thoughts cannot give birth to silence. It's like, wow, that's just what I needed to hear. Very profound. All these thoughts that we gather, they can't give birth to us. We're already born. We're the ever-born, actually. We're the eternally born. And we give, silence gives birth to itself. But thoughts cannot give birth to silence, whereas silence can give birth to these thought forms. But it doesn't go in reverse. Interesting, huh? So when all these thought forms come up, what are they doing? Are they trying to say, look, this is a modification, I can give birth to a modification of you? They can't, thoughts cannot give birth to silence. How can they? It's silence that gives birth to thoughts, to appearing, to ornamentation, and all that. So we're trying to reverse the direction of creation. So we think the thoughts have control of us, can affect us. They can't. Banish the thoughts for now. So this is, I had this craving to be with somebody who's banished their thoughts, because this is something that just by osmosis somehow it gets into you. Like by hanging out with Ramana Maharshi, for instance, you suddenly you have the will you just become aware. I have this, well, I just don't want thoughts anymore. So you're banished. You know, don't approach me, thoughts. I don't need you. I'm silence. I'm primary, prior to thought, to thinking and thoughts. I'm what gave rise to you. You don't give rise to silence. And they come and try to boss you, but you have to say, I'm the boss. So, but how do you get the will to do this? Is you hang out with the Dharma kings. That's why it's so important right now. And it's very frustrating. But we keep praying for this, to hang out with the Dharma kings, and just by osmosis, not by talking about it so much, but somehow you feel the will in them that they've done it. That they've done it. Somebody who's actually done this, free from thoughts, free from all thoughts. That is so helpful for us. That is what we need, actually. It is what everybody needs, even though they don't know it. Now, I was not even aware of this thought thing, actually. Everyone talked about thinking and thoughts. I didn't understand. What are they talking about? I don't know. I don't think hardly any of us really know exactly what do they mean. And then suddenly, I saw it. I said, oh my gosh. These thoughts are trying to obscure my experiencing, the joy of my experiencing. They're getting in the way of that. They're distracting me from my awareness. This is ridiculous. And somehow I suddenly had the will to take a look at it. I had the will to take a look at it. And then another poster expressed on Facebook how that just looking at it and seeing it generates its own intelligence. Very interesting quote. It was his own words, but he said, I said, I need to make a quick shift. He said, no, it's when you see it, it'll generate its own intelligence, which will simply push away the thinking. And this is true. So it's called the grace of the guru. Okay, so we need the grace of the guru. There's no question about it. Because thinking cannot dispel thinking, believe it or not. Thinking cannot dispel thinking. We hope that it will, but it doesn't. The thought, I want to get rid of thoughts, is just another thought. And we've heard the non-dual teachers say this, that's just another thought. Yeah, but they're just using methodology. It's a different thing when the grace of the guru is what actually allows it. It's not a thought that it takes place. It's this, our native intelligence finally decides to assert itself, and whew, that's it. One insight settles it all. So the grace of the guru, we've heard of this. Now I'm seeing why it is so important, and how a world cannot be a mentally healthy world at all if it rejects the gurus, the grace of the guru. Whether you call it the grace of Jesus Christ, the grace of Gautama Buddha, the grace of this, the grace of that. The principle, I understand the principle now. It's a way of speeding up the path to an enormous extent, and it's virtually indispensable, really. Whether the grace is through writings or in some way, you get a transmission of grace from the teacher that you suddenly have the will, the willingness to banish thoughts from your awareness. And that's when you become aware of the now, become aware of your native awareness, native condition, your true condition, the ever-born condition. There's no gap in our being born every second, every moment. So how can anything interfere with our continual birthing of freshness? We give birth to continual freshness, actually. We are the creators of this freshness. We give birth to freshness. Isn't that something? Wow. And that never stops. There's no gap. There's no gap. So I got my achy breaky body right now. I did get knee pads and elbow pads today, along with a pair of hybrid shorts for casual wear or beach wear, a pair of reef sandals, soft rubber sandals, thongs, and this shirt, and couple other little things. Trying to, you know, this is it. This is the push. The push is on. And we're trying to, I put more blue in this taping so you feel more blue, which is cool things down. Red is agitation, tends to be agitation. It depends how it's used. Blue tends to cool it down. The motif of blue has been a very strong one I've been noticing today and yesterday. And out of the blue, something just appearing out of the blue, help appearing out of the blue, troubles appearing out of the blue, something just out of the blue, something just is just going to, some maybe something very negative and something very positive then, or super positive, super negative, super positive, is likely to be the situation that we're facing now, the super negative and the super positive. And the problem is that most are not acquainted with the super positive, so they will keep trying to apply positivity to the super negative. And that's the mistake that is made that pulls us down into very acute psychoses. I saw someone in a car today. He was waiting at a stoplight, and suddenly he started acting in this bizarre fashion. It was just amazing. I think the Holy Spirit had me pay attention to him. He was sitting in his white van there, and suddenly he was going, ah, oh, oh. Like an epileptic seizure, just like this. I'm like, whoa, okay. And the Holy Spirit is showing me, you know, psychotic reaction. When we try to apply positivity to super negativity, we end up with a psychotic reaction, and our life goes into the trash bin. This particular experiencing tends to go into the trash bin. Happens all the time throughout history. It's happened. It's a brutal march we've been through in the history of this planet, is it not? It's a brutal, psychotic death march we've been through here. Just unbelievable. If you really look at it honestly and stop just always looking for a silver lining and look at the whole picture, it's just been absolutely psychotically brutal. This march through this world. We're marching through this world, but we are the ones that give birth to freshness every moment, actually. And when we see that, and then the thoughts do not get into any gap. There's no gap in us for the thoughts to get into. They keep trying to represent what we're doing, and then have a gap in it, and then have other thoughts get into those gaps. But thoughts are just getting into gaps of other thoughts. They're not getting into any gap, or not creating. There is no gap. There's no gap in creation. How could there be? Everything we desire simultaneously arises with our desiring, and it's always fresh. Each moment is fresh. This is reality. There are no gaps. So thoughts are all frauds. They're imposters. They're fraud. They're fraudulent. All thoughts are fraudulent, actually. All of them. Even beneficial thoughts. The super pot. Now, we use thinking, concepts, words, etc., to point this out. Okay. But those thoughts are still fraudulent. They're all equally fraudulent. There's no gap in reality. So there's no purpose for thoughts, or need for thoughts, or use for thoughts at all. Thoughts just see usages for other thoughts, but the whole purpose of it all is fraudulence, is to believe we can be modified. What we are can be and has been modified. And say, here's a picture of modification. Well, it's just a wishful thinking, right? Wishful thinking. All thinking is wishful thinking. It's not true that there's any gap in our creating freshness every moment. The Dharma kings, you feel freshness. You feel that freshness in their presence. In this is so profound in our own evaluation of our thinking. It's not how do we make our thoughts fresh. It's that we are creating freshness, ever freshness. This is what we are. This is what we do. We're spirit. An idea in the mind of God. So, yeah. Holy Spirit saying the whole world is going to be achy, 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 achy. People continue to not be so friendly in the world. Because deep down they're going, super negative's coming. Okay, well, do I have the positivity to handle it? And they're starting to get nervous and worried about that. Do I have the positivity to handle it? And the answer is, applying positivity to the super negative is the big mistake. So we have to be familiar with super positivity, and the problem is the world is not familiar with it. They keep dragging it into positivity, into what can thoughts do for me? What can thoughts do for me? No, it's what can the grace of the guru do for me? Is to ultimately help me banish thoughts and say, no, I don't need you any thoughts. I don't need thoughts. I can experience myself as thought-free, as free of thoughts. So the grace of the guru got into me on my 60th birthday, Ramana Maharshi. He gave me a tremendous gift of his grace. And so that is working within me. This is the grace of the guru works within us as this sort of inner will to banish thinking, banish thoughts. So when you feel this way, so I was in great shape, and when you take a fall like this, you feel like you've lost your conditioning overnight. You feel sluggish. You feel like, I can't do anything. I've lost my mojo, that kind of thing. And so the world will feel like, you know, we're making such great materialistic progress. There's so much abundance of positivity. It's the abundance of positivity which is the devil in this whole thing. Because this lures us away from the super positive. We say, we don't need to focus on the super positive so much because we have this abundance of positivity. And that'll be enough. We'll just throw a whole lot of positivity at the super negative. The super negative is not bothered by an abundance of positivity at all. It doesn't affect it at all. It doesn't cure it at all. It doesn't do anything to it. The super negative. The super negative is a whole different story. Only the super positive can trump the super negative. Not an abundance of positivity. Okay, it does nothing except a false sense. Maybe we're doing something, distracting us from super. In fact, super negativity sets itself up by getting everyone into a abundance of positivity mode, and then that's when it strikes. So it's actually a trap that it's set up. First, it lures us into to positivity, an abundance of positivity, which is what's happened to our world. All the while, it's super negativity setting this all up. It's the one that lures us into abundance of positivity. And then when we're really hooked, really addicted, and lost sight of super positivity, then super negativity pulls the rug out from underneath us. And then we plunge, free fall plunge into psychotic reaction, at which point there's a massive amount of presumed despair being generated, which we hope will change what we are. Instead of ever creating ever freshness, somehow we're creating despair, which is the opposite of freshness. You think, no, I'm stuck in this. There's no more freshness for me. Maybe it started fresh, but it's all decayed. It's all just decaying. Modification and decay, modification and decay. I'm stuck here in modification and decay forever. This is the, you know, ultimate despair. So the trap has been set. I've been preaching about this trap that's been set. You lose sight of super positivity. That's when, and you oblivious to it. That's when then the trap will be sprung upon us, and it affects everyone, affects the whole world. Everybody will be feel this. So, I don't know. I thought it was a stupid thing today. I don't know. I didn't get a wetsuit. I could have. I got other stuff that does nothing to do with the wetsuit. I don't know why I did that. I can't explain it. Maybe I don't want to go into the water. I mean, maybe, yeah, there's something there. So not yet. Don't force it. Okay. All right. Okay. As soon as I start thinking about that, I get the jitters. It's bad. So I did something else, which doesn't seem as utilitarian, but maybe it was a way of postponing that. You just have to trust it, trust it, trust it, trust it, trust it, trust it. So we're going to take a little, a little break here, as we've already gone over very, very intense subject matter here that food for consideration. Wow. Grace of the Guru. Getting tricked into positivity. Wow. Can you feel that? Now, I was one who was adamant from the day I was born that my focus was on super positivity. And the world tried to divert me into, no, we want an abundance of positivity. That's the siren song. Okay? That's the pagan goddess siren song. Give us an abundance of positivity, my hero. You know, what is that? That's super negativity seducing us into a trap. We should never focus on an abundance of positivity in the world. It should always be on super positivity here. These are what the religions all urge upon us. Austerity, austerity. Do not get caught in this trap of that super negativity is setting for us. It's a projection of the psychosis in our mind trying to double down on despair. This is exactly what's happening. So the world is about ready to be plunged into collective despair, which to try and avoid it, we get what's called psychotic reactions. And this is just, we try to go binging on positivity in some ways, in many different ways, and that starts getting bizarre, and it becomes very, very bizarre if it isn't bizarre enough already, the world, actually. I find it to be totally bizarre, the world, actually. Because nobody's doing what they need to be doing. Isn't that the definition of bizarre? Isn't it the same time you walk into the same time and say, wait a minute, nobody's here focused on what they need to focus on. There's something amiss here. That's this world. The world is nobody, almost no one is focused on what they need to be focused on. At all. They're just aimlessly wandering around looking for some positivity here, positivity there. Okay, I'm fine. I got this. So austerity, austerity, austerity. This doesn't mean severe deprivation, but the mood of austerity in your mind. I got a shirt. I got a blue shirt. I made sure to get this blue shirt. It's got a bunch of fish on it and a fishing reel, which means fisherman. I'm a fisherman here, fishing to help the fish out of the ocean of despair. And if the blue shirt is out of the blue being just seemingly out of nowhere, the Dharma kings appear, or we get help from them. As the rug is pulled out from underneath us, suddenly they're on the scene. Super positivity's on the scene. And so we need to start relating to super positivity. And I would love to get an opportunity to do more of that. So if they would start functioning in a proactive manner in that regard of really bringing us up to speed on super positivity, that we have access to it. I think most people in the world say, well, yeah, but where do I have any access to it at all, super positivity? Well, we try to give the flavor here as much as possible. Facebook, I try to give the flavor of that as much as possible. Facebook's a very interesting place. It is what you make of it, I guess you could say, like anything else. If you focus on super positivity, you get it. You get it. My legs are on fire. It's inflammation. There's a lot of inflammation when you take a fall like that. And it lasts and it spreads. Wow. Okay. Have a cherry juice cocktail. I know what I'm going to drink. I'm going to drink frozen strawberries with tart cherry juice. And what else could I need? Could I take for this? Maybe some protein. I have to get some protein to try and repair, you know, the damage of that big fall. Like a free fall. It was a free fall. It was just like I had the rug pulled out from underneath me. Just like that. Kaboom. So it didn't matter what shape I was in. Still hit real hard. Like, I was very surprised by that. Same thing in the world. We think that we're in great shape. Boom. We're going to hit real hard. So super positivity is the answer. And we could say super mega positivity for those tech people. You know, now it's super mega positivity. No, it's super mega dini positivity. Super mega dini positivity is what we need. And we'll get it. We'll get it. It's just a matter of familiarity. It is, again, I say the problem in the world is one of familiarity. That's the issue. And unless we recognize this is the issue, it's not about concepts, it's about familiarity. So super positivity, you just need to start getting used to it. That's all. Like Ramana just had people come to him, just be quiet. He gave them an opportunity to get used to him. You see this? Just sit, come here, just sit quietly. I'm just sitting quietly too. Wow. Big sneeze tried to hit me there. Holy cow. So he showed us what we need to do. Isn't that brilliant? He showed us what do we need to do. We need to sit quietly. We need to, so a skateboard, using a skateboard as a prop is a great idea. I forgot my skateboard today. I'm going to try and do some taping. Hey. I walked into Home Depot backwards today. Yeah, I did. I walked into Home Depot backwards. I said that I would, and I did it. I walked through the parking lot, the whole thing, all the way into the entrance, inside the store, backwards. It tired me out. I mean, when you do something like that, that is completely abnormal, but not in a negative way. It's in a aha, you know, like, let's do something. Can we do something? We can do something different. In other words, super positivity seems backwards to us. It does. But we can do it. And nobody batted an eye, actually, because just the way that I did it, no one paid any attention. But it was the perfect moment to do it, actually. It all happened spontaneously. Whereas I tried later, went to Home Depot again, I tried to do it there. I thought, no, it wasn't going to work. People had a different mood, different attitude. It wouldn't have flown there. The plane wouldn't have flown. But where I was earlier, it just flew. It just happened beautifully. Walked into Home Depot backwards. Can I get an amen from the congregation on that? I mean, are you kidding me? That's from idea to action. Okay, and that is where it's all, that's where it's at, from idea to action. I talked about it, and then I did it. But there's a gap sometimes. Well, there's a delay, let's say, between idea and action, which is why we think that there's a gap in our creating. There's not. It's what it is that we continue our creating, our experiencing, but we say, yeah, I'll do that at some point, and then we finally do it. But there's not really a gap taking place. We sort of delay it, because like, we're honoring time. We want to honor time. Like, well, I don't want to do it right away. It would look kind of odd. People think like, ah, it's kind of weird, because we're supposed to, everyone's here supposed to, you know, agree to honor process, like that there's some process happening to us, even though there isn't. Like the body's subject to process. So no, you can't just heal that like that. It's got to heal naturally, they call it, meaning through process, this illusion of process. They call that naturally. That's totally unnatural. It's bizarre, completely bizarre. So what is this place? Are the people getting sick? So, well, just choose to be well. What's the problem? No, we don't do that here. So how do you cover the world and maintain your sanity is only a few have done it, actually. Only a few have done that. That's how difficult it is. So we don't beat ourselves up because we didn't do it. I tried my best, wasn't able to do it. Have to do better. I mean, it's the toughest of the toughest coming here and try to maintain your sanity. Jesus did it. He says, "You're sick? Okay, get up and walk. Your faith has made you whole." Yeah, Jesus didn't use any process in his miracles at all, did he? He just declared it so, and it was so. That's called sanity. Jesus was sane, okay? And we are suffering from very poor mental health. Very poor mental health here. This is the place we come to pursue terrible mental health, actually. So people say, oh, I love the world. My mind is so wonderful. They're saying, this world's so helpful because it's really helped me develop a very bad mental health, which they think is salvation, because they think that's ultimately going to be able to modify what we are. And it doesn't. It doesn't. You're just stuck with bad mental health. You realize, oh my gosh, I can't modify myself. And what do I have for my efforts? Terrible mental health. And they say, uh-oh. The Holy Spirit, you ask for help, Holy Spirit shows up, and the rest is history. Then there's a path towards ultimately perfect mental health here. So I've been preaching the right message of super positivity, but it's difficult to keep it going, to tell you the truth, because there's just no response, almost none. There's a little, very little. I appreciate the responses that there are, but it's people are just like, blah, I got to go chase after positivity. If I just have more positivity. No, it's apples and oranges. It's like the difference between spreading fertilizer on their lawn and watering it. It's like people keep spreading more fertilizer on their lawn, but they don't water it. I need more fertilizer. The lawn's still dry. Let me pour more fertilizer. Oh, it's burning. The lawn's all burned out. It's dying. Oh, let me spread more fertilizer. Hey, guess what? You're supposed to water the lawn. It's like imagine your front lawn, your lawn is dying because of no water. And you say, gosh, I better spread some fertilizer on that lawn. It looks like it's losing its color and everything. That's horrible. And so you keep, but you don't water it. You keep spreading more fertilizer. This is a perfect analogy, as far as analogies go, a very good one, you might say, for what's happening in the world right now. Psychosis is like your lawn is dying because of no water, and every morning you keep throwing more fertilizer on it. And then someone says, hey, I see your lawn is dying. Have you tried watering it? What? What are you talking about? What good is water going to do? It doesn't have enough fertilizer. I got to put more fertilizer on it. I said, no, you're putting too much fertilizer. It's killing the lawn. Huh? What are you talking about? No, you put fertilizer on the lawn if it looks like this. That's what I'm told, and the authorities have told me this. So I'm doing what the authorities tell me to do. The ego tells me to do this. I'm doing the right thing, but somehow the lawn's not responding because I've not put enough on. I got to put more. And they're just like this. The mind, the psychotic mind, is like that. They keep doubling down on the wrong thing to do. It's not a fertilizer problem we have. It's a water problem. Water the lawn. Unless you're in California. Then we put in fake lawns. No water, no fertilizer. Problem solved. Yeah, but it's not living. Ah, well, yeah. Doesn't feel alive. We have a lot of artificial lawns now, and there's something about them that kind of gives me the creeps a little bit, actually. Really. It's just like a carpet. Putting carpet, green carpet. Shaggy shag carpet. Green shag carpet outside. I mean, come on. Where is the ecosystem there? Pretty soon we'll be having fake plants outside, actually. And then we've already got the fake people. We just need the fake plants. We've got the fake grass and the fake people. Next thing's fake plants and fake food. Well, the food's already pretty fake, isn't it? Parmesan cheese. Well, you add wood cellulose to stabilize the cheese. And then they said, well, yeah, it's mostly wood cellulose, but it's seasoned wood cellulose. Oh, okay. Wood cellulose seasoned with Parmesan flavor. I don't know how bad it is. I still use this, regular Parmesan. It tastes good, but maybe it's just seasoned cellulose. Again, even when we think we've done right preparation, having the rug pulled out from under us, it's going to hurt. So we need the super positivity. We need access. We need now. It may be enough. Most won't be able to handle direct access. Some will be able to handle direct access. Some can handle second-hand access. Some can handle third-hand access. Some fourth-hand access. In other words, let's say I can handle direct access with super positivity, in the guise of Dharma Kings. It's really super positivity of this sanity, perfect mental health, of formless spirit creating freshness every moment. So I can, let's say I can handle that. Then someone else, I can tell them about it, and they can get this through me, and they say, well, I know someone who has direct contact with the Dharma Kings. That's really wowish, isn't it? I know I have a friend who has direct contact with them, Dharma Prince, direct contact. Wow. And people say, oh my gosh, that's amazing. So they're secondhand, and then they tell their friends, like, hey, I've got a friend who has direct access to the Dharma Kings. And they say, you do? You're a friend of a friend of the Dharma Kings? Wow. So that's third hand. And then they tell their friends, and they say, they're at the gas station, say, hey, feeling down. Hey, you know what? I've got a friend. I know a friend of mine has a friend who has direct access to the Dharma Kings. That's fourth hand. So the ones that they're telling, that's their fourth hand. And so fourth handers go, oh my gosh. And then maybe they tell others, say, hey, you know what? I met this person at the gas station, and they have a friend who has a friend who has direct access to the Dharma Kings. That would be fifth hand. And so it kind of spreads out that way. But for many, that's enough. And at some point, they say, you know what? I have a connection to the Dharma Kings. Yeah, I have a friend who met somebody who has a friend who has direct access to the Dharma Kings. Wow. So I'm connected to super positivity. I know about it. I'm aware of it. So you see how it spreads out in this way. So it may seem like, oh, direct contact, what good is that going to do? Well, you tell your friends, they tell their friends tell their friends, and their friends tell their friends, and something in them says, I do have some connection to super positivity. And then this turns the tide, starts turning the tide in their minds. They say, hey, I don't have to keep, it's not about positivity. Positivity is failing me, but I have some awareness of super positivity. And this is what the 60s and 70s was all about, is these people going over to India and Tibet and Nepal, etc. Well, at that point it was more Nepal, because the Tibetans were chased out of Tibet in 1959, pretty much so, right? So they went to Nepal and Dharamsala, India, and various places where Tibetans were in India. And they met these Rinpoches, lamas, and gurus, and all this stuff. They actually, some of them actually met them. Others had friends who met them. And then they came back to the West, Europe, Australia, United States, throughout the world. And they said, hey, did you go to India? Yeah, I was in India. And did you meet the gurus? I didn't meet the gurus, but I had a friend that actually, met him and stayed with them for a couple of weeks, actually. Really? You have a friend that met the Tibetan Rinpoche, name of master? Are you kidding me? Really? You have a friend that met them? Wow. So that would be like third hand. So the friend met the Nyingma masters, that's first hand. Then your friend that's a friend of your friend, so that's second hand. And then you would be third hand. And then you'd say to people, I'm really down, I don't know what's going on. They say, well, hey, like Tibetan, maybe Tibetan Buddhism might help. Yeah, I actually have a friend who was over in India, and they had a friend who actually spent time with the Rinpoche. And we'd say, really? Wow, so that's fourth hand. This is what was happening. And I imagine it's still happening today. I personally, I don't know anyone right at this point that's met anybody. Maybe because I'm the one who's doing the meeting. I don't know. That sort of seems to not be as strong as it used to be. But we used to really, as we say, groove on that. I mean, because that got us hooked up with super positivity. Oh my gosh. So word of mouth spreads this information. Silicon Valley, you know, it's a desert. You don't know anybody that's met anybody. So any super positivity. They say, oh, yeah, I got a friend that has a friend that met, you know, CEO of this tech company. Really, you know, Steve Jobs, you met someone, you know, I got a fifth hand associates with Steve Jobs. That's unbelievable. You know, they're like that. I've never met anyone like that, though. I don't have any association with any of these tech people. No association. So we want super positivity to be in the house. Longchampa's in the house. So I mean, if you're listening to me, you're listening to someone who has had direct association with the Dharma Kings. Jesus Christ, Ananda Mahima, Ram Maharshi, Longchampa, Jamya and Kenzi Choki Lodro, and Padmasambhava. So I've had direct association with all these Dharma Kings. So that's direct association, long-term direct association with these Dharma Kings. So that's super positivity right there. So you can tell your friends, hey, I know, I have a friend who has had these direct associations. That's very important. People are not understanding this. They don't understand how super positivity spreads out. It's not happening on Facebook, really. People look at a picture of Ram Maharshi and say, ah, great. But isn't it even more vital that somebody's had a direct association connection, experience of him? First-hand association with Ram Maharshi. Isn't that more important? But that's not happening. It's not happening. This is something that's, I'm tearing my hair out. I've had direct association with Sri Sri Nandamaya, direct experience with Sri Sri Anandamayi, as I might say, the Bhagavani herself, direct, many experiences, direct experiences with the Bhagavani. I call it the Bhagavani. Now, I must admit that when I posted that, I felt I got a very strong indication from her. The people responded greatly to that. So the willingness may be there, but I can't make these things up. I have to actually, you know, have a direct experience. You know, this is the thing. You can't play with people's emotions. It has to be something that you profoundly feel, that you've experienced, and you share it because it's honest and legitimate. So like I have a Facebook page that, you know, Jesus is back, because I share what my experience is, a direct experience with Jesus Christ. Very powerful. Speaking with him directly, relating with him as an equal, as a friend, is an extraordinarily powerful experience I had. So I share that. But I don't know, I haven't gotten like zero comments on the Facebook page for, it's been over a year, and almost a year and 16 months. I don't know if I've got, maybe I don't know. It's bizarre. It's just not spreading out. People are so caught up in positivity, abundance of positivity. They keep thinking, no, that's going to help me. It's not. It's not going to help you. I've said this from the very beginning. That's death to you. It's death to you. Now, we don't have to completely ignore it. I mean, so I got a few things today. I show you the shirt, the fish shirt. I don't know if you can see, those are fish. There's all different types of fish. It's another Jack O'Neill shirt. It's very comfortable. It's very long. I like that. It's very long. Remember when we were young, we got these shirts that are really long. I like long shirts. It's cool. It gives you a little... This one's long. So I say, I'm going to get this. This is a cool shirt. It's very, very comfortable. Very comfortable cotton. So that's, you know, we don't have to get rid of positivity. It's just, it has to take its place, its rightful place, which is a very subservient position. Okay? So all those who are involved in positivity should recognize that they're taking a very, very subservient position, and ultimately a needless one, a meaningless, needless one. But honoring our creativity will give it some air, okay? But you have to realize it's a very subservient thing. And this isn't happening in the world. So all this stuff, I mean, I'm not out there I'm not an anarchist towards technology and all this stuff. I boycott most of it. Because of necessary austerity, we can't get caught up in this. But, you know, it has a place here in the world, so okay. But it should know its place. It doesn't know its place. It keeps thinking, we're it. No, you're not it. They should be going and saying, we're not it. Technology is not it. Technology is positivity. Positivity is never it. Positivity is never it. It does not free us from our psychosis, the super negative psychosis we're in. Only super positivity, only the grace of the guru does that. The grace of the Holy Spirit is the grace. The grace of the guru is the grace of the Holy Spirit, which is the grace of God, actually. It's all the same grace. Only that frees us, and that's super positive. It's super positive. And when we see the super positive, we say, oh my God, that is fantastic. That there's no gap in my freshness. There never has been. You see, what do you do then? Oh, wow. And that just then positivity, you realize it's just paper money. It's funny money. It's monopoly money. But we're not, you know, here to denigrate it. We're here just to put it in its right place. It's totally subservient. So in Darshan, you're there for super positivity. You're not there for positivity. You know, leave your smartphone, turn off your smartphones, get away from this frivolity of positivity, your search for more and more positivity. That's a sign that you're headed for a drastic fall. Headed for a drastic fall. When super negativity has got you in its jaws, then the jaws slam shut. What do you think? You got the great white sharks flashing the pearly whites, and when you just come on, look up, look how nice my lips are, my pearly white teeth come in, and take a look at the inside of my teeth. They're so also wonderful. So you climb inside the mouth of the shark. You're looking, and the shark says, "Aren't my teeth splendid and beautiful?" And my gums are bright ruby red. I put lip gloss on my gums, inside my gums. Oh, isn't that wonderful? And you're saying, "Yeah, shark." And then once you're fully inside the mouth of the shark, guess what happens? Wham! The mouth slams shut. So we better start watering our lawn. Watering our lawn means super positivity. Putting more fertilizer on the lawn is positivity. Actually, the water has everything that the lawn really needs. It has the freshness the lawn needs. What we're showing is a lack of freshness here. The water symbolizes freshness, and that's what we really need, the freshness. The Bhagavani was a supermodel modeling our freshness to us. It says, this is what you really are. Fred, this ever freshness. She was ever fresh. She could change her body in an instant from cancer to no cancer, and she did so. She allowed the appearance of cancer to be metastasized everywhere in her body. Doctor says it's the worst case I've ever seen. This, you must be in absolute agony. And she goes, no, I don't feel. I feel perfectly fine. I feel fresh as a daisy. Doctor says, it's not possible. You're just saying that. It's not going to give her morphine. And he was witness to. She decided, okay, or Kayal decided that was enough of this appearing. And in an instant, the cancer vanished and her body was perfectly cancer-free. Doctor came back the morning. Examiner says, no sign of cancer anyway. So that's just impossible based on the laws of nature. Laws of nature. What? There are no laws of nature, folks. Okay, nature doesn't. The laws of nature, what we call nature, mean laws of nature, meaning form following process, is an illusion. It doesn't exist. Never has. So in an instant, our body could appear as perfectly fresh. It always was perfectly fresh. But for some reason, having this appearance of cancer, maybe she wanted to show that, showcase it to us, what we can do for all the sickness in the world, how it, to treat it really is simply decide, choose a new idea, choose to appear ever fresh, choose to accept what you really are, which is this, we give birth to fresh, we give birth to ourselves continuously. There isn't any room for death to enter in at all. None. Zero. How we do it here? Oh, we're cruising along. Very warm day today. Somebody, you know, it's funny. The weather, internet weather, online channels, just, they're erring on the side of caution. It's just boilerplate. They go on norm. They're not even going on norms. They say, well, it's going to be, you know, cool 70s. Long-term forecast. And then they kind of adjust it as they go along. They're not really forecasting at all, actually. It's weird what they're doing. They're not professional forecasters. Tabloid weather people. And, you know, they say the next 10 days really cool, abnormally cool. No, it's 95 today. 95, and it's going to be hot again tomorrow. It's like, what? Where did this come from? It's all good. Oh, man. So, I'm having to drag this achy body around right now and you know, I don't feel so good, to tell you the truth. But I'm focusing on super positivity, and you know what? That knocks it out. So whatever you can do to knock someone out with super positivity. I got a friend request yesterday on Facebook by someone who's very austere and determined and focused, spiritually focused, and it was a really great friend request, actually. It's really an honor. I've gotten some really great friend requests recently. And all along, I've gotten some really good friend requests, actually. There's some really quality people there. Some are heavily into positivity, but that helps me see it. So I enjoy that, too, because I get to see their posts of all these super positive, I mean, all these posts of positivity. Some flowers here, flowers there, a lot of flowers, a lot of nature shots and stuff. That ain't going to get it done, folks. It's not going to get it done. So sit on your skateboard. Use it as an asana, a seat, to sidestep the problems. Instead of skating, sit on your skateboard. In other words, see, and then consider super positivity. Instead of being active in a certain way, you know, take your what you're active with and give it a different usage. I'm going to just sit on the skateboard instead of skate on it. And use an abundance of super positivity now. An abundance. In other words, the knee pads, the elbow pads. Like I have the wrist guards, the helmet, knee pads, elbow pads. But hip pads, I don't know. I haven't got those yet. I may have to work on that one. The hips, I realize, are very vulnerable as you get older. It's scary, isn't it? I never thought about that before. It's like they're right there, the hip bone. And boy, you need to have very supple hip bones, don't we, in life? So here's to supple hip bones for everyone. Here's to being really hip. The others of hipsters is the way they walked, with this swaying their hips back and forth together. They have this loose walk. It's kind of a drug walk. It's kind of a, I don't know, they had a certain way of walking, and whereas most people were walk robotically, whereas the hipsters walked in a different, their body language is very different. Loose hips, they call it, very loose hips. And most people in the corporate 50s, oh my gosh, the clothing, everything was very so restrictive that we all walked in a very linear, we were trying to be a super efficient. Well, this is a, where everything is efficiency. We're in this mania of efficiency, which drove me nuts, because I'm not that. I never even think about efficiency in that way at all. I think about super positivity. I don't think about it. I mean, I feel it. I feel I feel this desire for super positivity. This is what I desire. So this has attracted these Dharma kings to me. Because I say, oh, you want super positivity? We feel you want super positivity. I say, yeah. Okay, well, we have some for you. Oh, thank you. This is wonderful. Great. So is nature enough? No. No, it's not. We have to get into the super positive. We have to start experiencing the grace of God, actually. And I need more tonight. I need a lot. I need a lot. Because I'm aware, like, wow, I got a lot of responsibility here. If I'm firsthand connection with super positivity, then that's a lot of responsibility to the second hand, third hand, fourth hand, fifth hand, sixth, etc., etc. It's a lot of responsibility. It's very important because most of us cannot approach firsthand contact. It's too scary for us. The wow is simply too scary. We're going to retreat into just fanatic positivity. You know, it'll just. It's difficult to say the least. I spent a lifetime working on it. That's all I think about. It's all I feel is how can I have firsthand contact with the Dharma kings? That's all I've ever really considered in my life. Started out with Yogananda, autobiography of a yogi, where he had all this firsthand contact, you know, and also he had contact with those who had direct contact. He had so much direct contact. It just blew my mind. I just said, that is great. That's what I want. That's what I want. So he sort of lit the fuse for me, Yogananda, of having this direct contact. I said, yeah, that's what we need in the West. You know, come on, let's have it. And so he gave us secondhand contact in the West by coming here. So people would say, well, I know Yogananda, who had direct contact with, you know, I mean, Babaji, Lahiri Mahasaya, Sri Yukteswar, Sri Sri Anandamayama. My God, he had direct contact with Sri Sri Anandamayama, the Bhagavani yourself. Yes, on a number of occasions, I believe. So he had direct contact with these Dharma kings and gurus and masters. And he came here to the West, California, set up Self-Realization Fellowship, etc., etc. And this is very, very, very important here for us. But I don't know if I ever met anyone that met Yogananda. I don't think I did. So I ended up having direct contact myself. That was my destiny. But I was really keen on that and have remained keen on that always. That was my purpose in life. I was born with that desire. That's what I'm going to do. So I'm still waiting for... There's nothing physically external that I've had contact with. That's okay. Maybe it's going to be internal. But this is, you know, very serious issue with me. I mean, it's not anything to play with. You know, it's nothing frivolous to joke about or play around with. Like, no, this is totally serious, because this is what we need to help our mental health. And mental health is a totally serious issue, actually. I take it, you know, with 100% seriousness, while still not fixating, so I lose the sense of freshness, and, you know, of course. But I am absolutely serious about it. Knowing how bad our mental health can get, having experienced it, oh, I know how bad it can get. And that is no joking matter. And the potentiality for acting it out is limitless. I mean, we can act it out in infinite ways, actually. And each one of these ways can produce like side trips that can go on for a long, long time and can produce just massive entanglements. And so you need the grace of God to not go on those side trips. And I looked at some of them, so I went a little bit on some of them to see, oh yeah, wow, that can just go on and on and on, and you're just lost in other worlds and civilizations and cycles of samsara, and yeah, absolutely. So it's an extraordinarily serious thing to take your mental health with the utmost seriousness here, and to treat it in the right way, which is through super positivity. That which is beyond thinking and thoughts. We have to come into contact with this and have some association with it. So I'm keep praying, you know, and pray for me, pray for yourself, pray for everyone in the world right now, that we get this chain of association going. It is super important. It's how it's done. I wouldn't have the success I've had now without this chain of association, like coming from Yogananda, for instance, coming from those who went to the East, coming from those who had, you know, connections and through this chain of association, saying, you know what, I can get into super positivity. I feel like that some way I can do it. Otherwise, you know, wow. And I did have, somehow I had some chain of association with New Thought through my grandmother and both grandmothers, and you know, there was it trickles down to you somehow in many, many ways. And so I was able to get with A Course in Miracles. I knew it was coming in, so I was already aware before I was born that this was coming in to help me. So I was aware of that. So I already had association with Jesus before I was born. So I was able to get with that and was able to accept the super positivity of it and take it as a super positive influence instead of just a super abundant positive influence, which some tried to spin it that way as just, this is, well, look at this great abundance of positivity here. And the Holy Spirit, Jesus said, no, don't pay attention to that. Don't worry about that. That's not going to stop us. Okay, but yeah, that happened. That happens, of course. Is those, the psychosis thinks that they can treat super negativity through positive abundance of positivity. That's the sickness. So that sickness keeps playing even when they come in contact with help like A Course in Miracles. They will react to it that way. But I did not react to it that way. I had already been preconditioned, you know, my desire was to embrace super positivity. So I took it that way, in the right way. And that has led to, you know, a great deal of super positivity and familiarity with it. The Enigma Masters, I mean, you talk about super positivity. That's astonishing super positivity that they have managed to keep going. This is an astonishment, actually. And they are to be given the highest commendation for this. That is so difficult to do here. That in itself is super positivity. Just wow. And so the reaction to super positivity is not more, it's not thinking, but wow. Wow. Because the oscillation of thinking is going to try to get a hold of you and say, I think I can show you a gap here. You know, let me help you out. Let me bring this down into positivity. That'll help you. Yeah, because we're told thoughts, oh, you're very helpful thoughts, because they help us give the illusion that we can modify ourselves. So we think our thoughts, we've told them, you're very helpful, we need more thinking and thoughts. And they, so they come to you and say, let me help you out. Let me bring the super positive down into the positive. And let's have abundant positivity. Yeah, you got to stop that, you know, that ultimately. That's not it. Ah. The achy body. See, I don't take any medications or drugs. I don't take Advil or Aleve or whatever people take. No. I experience this. How can we use super positivity to get, you know, banish this achy feeling? What a beautiful fall that was. It was an awesome pratfall. Full body slam. Full unexpected body slam. You don't get that very often in life, do you? So it's a real treat when you really take a fall like that. That wasn't the tumble, you know, like trip and roll and tumble. That was a complete whoop up in the air, bam! The full weight of the body and everything just crush into the ground. Full body slam. Great. Caught unawares. That's the key. We're caught unawares. So the super negativity will catch us unawares. It's very good. Like a thief in the night, Jesus says. It comes like a thief in the night. He was very aware of the super negativity. You must prepare with super positivity. With the grace of God, Jesus told us very clearly and accurately, correctly. He most certainly has and is and will give us this super positive, correct guidance, the grace of God. Got the crickets working tonight, don't we? Yeah. Ah, what am I going to have? Those good organic frozen strawberries and the, tart red cherry juice. Yeah, that should be nice. Looking forward to that a little bit. Not much. I have a hard time getting excited about food. I really don't. I try to. It's like, it's not that great. That's always my feeling. Like, that's just positivity, isn't it? Food. People are obsessed with food. They're so obsessed right now. They're so obsessed. It's all over everywhere, isn't it? Food, 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 food. The Titanic is ready to hit an iceberg. Everybody's obsessed with drinking and dancing and gambling and food. In other words, what? Abundance of positivity. Superabundance of positivity instead of an abundance of super positivity. You see hear the difference? Feel the difference. 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 So they're all into, I need more positivity. Okay. Bread and circuses everywhere. Bread and circuses. Please give me bread and circuses. This is psychosis. You know, more dancing. More, you know, skimpy outfits, beautiful bodies dancing around. More good food while I pay attention to this. More drugs while I pay attention to this. More wine, more this, more that. I need this. More positivity. Come on. So they're trying to self-medicate with positivity, which only makes it worse. It's the whole world are just addicts. Positivity addicts, actually. It's an addiction. It's a terrible addiction, which is why religions preach austerity, 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 self-control, austerity. Danger, a lot of danger everywhere, for all of us. Yoga girls say, come swing with me, you know, come swing, let's dance the positivity dance together, darling. It'll be so wonderful, so much sweet love will come of it, you know. This is addiction, they're severely addicted. And they're pushers, they're drug pushers, pushing the drug of positivity to get you hooked and make you even more hooked. This is what they are, they're really drug pushers, the yoga girls, they're drug pushers. Come drink the sweet wine of positivity with me. And they, a dreamy look in their eye, you know, the dreamy look in their eye. Oh, it'll be such a wonderful death we experience together. Yeah. It'll be such a wonderful psychosis. We'll set sail on the ocean of psychosis. And we'll have such wonderful storms together, you and me. I could put it into poetry, I suppose. But it would be rancid compared to our bard, our Spanish bard here, the great poet. Totally rancid. Nothing can compare. The Iberian bard. We have to get some more poetry from our Iberian bard. Yeah, absolutely. I have to ask him. We need it. We need help. We need this super positivity help. It's sort of a bridge between super positivity and positivity poetry. It really is. It's a great bridge, actually. People need help. I mean, I'm very aware those are in very nasty situations. The yoga girls are singing their siren song. Sweetly singing. No matter how sweetly they sing it, the net result is greater fear of truth, feeling greater feeling of that truth is a threat, and then feeling that reality is an abyss. That's the result of indulging in abundance of positivity, which is called materialism. Is you end up feeling that truth is a very threatening, extremely threatening to you, because it leads you to a reality, which is what, an abyss. This is the result. Doesn't matter how sweet the siren songs of the yoga girls are. Come swing with me in our cruise boat of abundant positivity, where we sail the oceans of psychosis and dance in the storms together, and dance in all these storms together, you and me, the net result is you end up with this dreadful fear of truth and terror of reality, as if it's an abyss of annihilation. That's always the result of it, no matter how it seems to start out so sweetly the song, siren songs are. That's what actually happens. Inescapably, that's what happens. But like a sugar addiction, you know, we keep going back to it. Like some sort of caffeine addiction. Ah, I better go back to it. I'm feeling nervous. Well, of course you're going to feel nervous because you're approaching super positivity, which you have thought is threatening. And the reality is an abyss. So of course you get nervous as you approach super positivity. But you have to let those nerves subside in the wow. Like, wow, I'm approaching it. Wow, that's great. So you have to give yourself this pep talk. Super positive pep talk. Like, this is wonderful. Wow. Wow is the tool of super positivity. It's the most important tool there is. You have to apply it, though. It's like a skill saw building a house. You know, it's a nice thing to have a skill saw, isn't it? And a table saw. Most certainly is. You can really use a skill saw for everything, just about. If they put some area on it for a hammer, you could actually use it as a hammer too and build the whole house with just a skill saw. Very, very, very necessary tool. So the wow is our skill saw in the path of super positivity. We have to apply it to what we're doing, and that transforms it all into a super positive experience. Whereas if you don't use that, it's still on the level of abundant positivity. It's trouble. We need to use the poetry to respond to those in trouble. They're in big trouble. I'm aware of this. Some great, 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 wonderful minds are in big trouble right now. They really are. The trap is a nasty, nasty trap. And poetry can really help them, actually. Poetry can really help them. Because they can say, I got some even better poetry than you have, yoga girl. You know, you seductress into positivity. Giving me this feeling like I can approach super positivity. I don't really need you to help me approach super positivity because you don't really help me approach it. You help me indulge in more abundant positivity. Sex, drugs, rock and roll, so to speak, like that. But that never really, that actually I feel I'm kind of like backsliding in some way. It's kind of like you drink all these soft drinks and it doesn't really quench your thirst. After a while, you got this raging thirst for more because of the sugar and everything they put in it makes you more thirsty. That's true. They do it on purpose, of course. So you drink more, so you consume more, so they make more profits. It doesn't slake your thirst, really, whereas water really does. So drink the waters of super positivity. That's where it's at. So I'm not going to make this one really long, because I know we're all pressed for time, and I understand people don't have the time right now to watch all these videos. I understand. I have to keep taping to keep the momentum going, okay? I don't just stall out because people aren't listening. Can't do that. So I better get about my business here. And we got to get the ball rolling here. Mental health, global mental health alert has been declared by the Dharma Kings, which means as of September 6th, as of today, which means we now need to take extraordinary measures, extraordinary super positive measures, and be proactive.